is Checkpoint. I'm here, Paul Busharizi, your host, discussing with Mr. Aga Sekalala Jr. on business in its various forms.
You've survived this really rough, the rough seas. And now you say, okay, we're strong enough. We've got a bit more boat to carry us in these waters. We will continue to chart on. And I think I would say that more than per se to say that all of a sudden there is a transition. What I do know is that a lot of the times it is to decide, do you as an investor or do you as a businessman want to stay running this business on a day-to-day, or are you ready for this business to become a professionally run business? That's also another transition. Do you need to hire managers? Do you want to make it professionally run? Do you want it in such a way that professionals can come and do their thing and they know what they are doing, they set their goals, you set up the proper governance structure, and from there, you sort of maybe take a little bit more, even though you're the founder, you're the driver, you take a bit of a back seat. And it happened. We were very successful at that with our media business. And we were able to make that transition
to step back,
yes. And you know, it is something that we've been happy that we've been able to do.
Does ambition play a part in making that transition from necessity business to opportunity business?
It does. You have to do two things. And I think you have to do two things. First one is you have to first and foremost, with like all businesses, you have to agree in your mind that this is not your personal piggy bank. So you accept that you are, even though you've set up this business, you're a steward of this business. And I like that word, being a steward, is very important. You agree that, look, I'm running this business for posterity. I'm running this business for the long term. There will be a small amount that the business might be able to pay as a dividend when the time is right, when times are good. When times are bad, we might actually have to take money out of our pocket and invest in the business. And that's what a shareholder does. That's what a true shareholder is about. But lastly, you need to have, once you have all of those things in place, you then cannot treat the business like a piggy bank. You go there like an ATM and you pick up money on the weekend. On Friday, pick up the money. You're like, call for the money. Let me get the money. If you behave in that way, then certainly it continues to just remain a lifestyle business. Once you decide that, you know, all the money that's collected goes to the bank, it's accounted for, we have audited accounts, we decide when and how we can distribute the money.
If there is anything to distribute,
then you have made that transition, a proper transition. So it's a lot about, yes, your ambition, it's a lot about your attitude towards the business, but it is also about how you behave towards the business. So you see this all the time, and I see them every day. I count the petrol stations on my way. I work in Majije. I count the number of petrol stations, and then I count the number of petrol stations after a month, and then you notice that the petrol stations go down in number. They change. Petrol station is no longer there. So petrol stations tend to be very much a business where people treat them as a piggy bank. And so sooner or later you notice that the petrol station changes structure, and then one day you wake up and it has been rebranded and the big boys have taken it. But you see them and they start out and it is a no name. You know, sometimes it has completely no name. But it is an opportunity. The person has seen it, he's put a tank, he's got a bit of land, he's set it up over there. And you see people stop and pick up kerosene, sometimes buy a bit of diesel, but then What is your goal in setting this up? What's your goal? Since you just want a little bit of money? If you just want a little bit of money for the weekend, then that's what it's going to be.
And it will not last.
It will not last. If you want a bit of money for the weekend, that's what the ambition you've set for the business. If you think about the business long term and say, look, I want to grow this business to have 5 big petrol stations in the major outlets going out of town and have an ecosystem around us and, you know, all those things. And if you're thinking about it from that perspective, you will notice that your behavior will be very different. Yes, naturally.
That's interesting, because it suggests also there's a mindset issue.
Correct.
Where do you go to learn this stuff?
That's a good question. Where do you go? Where do you go? Where is the school?
Yes,
good question. I think it's a little bit of the school of the street. You've got to go to the school of the street. I think you've got to work with these people. You've got to work with people who've done this before. You've got to if you come from an old civil service background, and you know, you grew up and your mom worked in the ministry and your dad worked as a teacher somewhere, and you've never had exposure, you could benefit by even doing an internship. You could benefit by dipping in and saying, you know what, I'm going to dedicate 3 or 5 years, work with one of these people. You need to, you know, find the one that works for you, mm-hmm. and understand how this works. And unfortunately, there is just simply no shortcut, because if you go
you
to
have school, to go in and get hit.
If you go to school, they will teach you a lot about finance. They will teach you about what a profit and loss statement is, but they do not teach you that you need to have a certain attitude towards and a certain discipline. That tends not to be something that I think is taught. But I think also business and training of business is changing. I think I see a lot of
maybe the problem is the people who teach business are not businessmen.
That also could be. I see a lot of business people now are doing what we are doing now. And I think that's the purpose of this sort of thing, is to sort of make people self-aware, first of all, about who they are and what they are made of, and to say, what is it that I might be lacking? Because most of the time, I think that is important. What is it that I might be lacking that I might require? And so what's the gap? Where is the gap that I might have? So I think it's, you know, if you get out there and choose... There's quite a bit of business people speaking. Follow them on their, you know, on their Twitter pages. They can be playful sometimes. Mm-hmm. That's not to say that they will always be very serious. Sometimes that's not the intention, is to educate you. But you know, if you take on a talk circuit in a year, you will find. You know, a lot of entrepreneurs will speak at least once or twice a year. If you follow carefully, you will get a chance to listen and read their books, and you pick up something. Then you need to work with somebody one for a little bit. Mm-hmm. I worked with very good businessmen, so I think that was very important for me. And you know, coming from a family that's a business family. These were dinner table discussions from a very early age.
So there's a lot of stuff that you picked up by the way, but have served you well over the years.
Yes, correct.
There's something interesting. When you did the other talk, you talked about building, and I think it goes to the same subject, building financial readiness, you called it, in your companies, companies.
Okay.
What is this, and why should we care?
Financial readiness. I think it's a term I coined as we prepared for that particular talk with Brenda. The issue was around. Are you ready to talk? You want money, you need money, but are you ready for the money? Are you ready for the questions you're going to be asked about this money?
What do you mean? We're all ready for the money. If you give me the...
Yes, we always want the money.
Yes.
The money,
okay.
The money is wanted. Yes. Now that part is there.
Yes.
But are you ready, one, to use that money, to utilize the money properly? That's the first question. Mm-hmm. But the only way you show that you're ready to utilize the money is by, A, being able to show that the money that you had yesterday, you used it well. There is no other way, because mm-hmm. ultimately nobody has any proof in front of them until they see how you used the little money that you had the other day.
A record.
And a past record. What's your track record of using money? And that's where these questions start to come up. So you walk into your friendly bank. First and foremost, I always tell everybody, you know, a lot of people who talk to, you walk into the bank, don't expect that you're going to get that money tomorrow. The advert on TV says you're going to get the money in 2 days. 48 hours, 24 hours, you get the money, you walk away with the money. But it is, there is at the, what you don't see on the advert is that there is a fine print at the bottom.
Terms and conditions apply.
Subject to terms and conditions. So the terms and conditions actually is when you walk into the bank, they'll ask you, okay, so for your business, do you pay taxes? Do you have a TIN number? For this business, okay, that you set up, do you have employees? How many are they? Did you pay the full taxes for them in the previous year? Yes or no? Your company records, what does your company do? If you produce a foodstuff, are you certified by UNBS? Has somebody ever come to your business to just make sure that that things are okay? Or if you're, like we are, maybe like we've been, I saw talk about the media business earlier, do you have a permit from the broadcasting, UCC, from the council? Do you have a media council permits? Those are all questions. You have to be able to have evidence that everything that you do has been done. And I think these are all part of, sometimes technically, they will call it a legal due diligence, a business due diligence that will have to be done.
By the one who wants to give you money.
By the one who wants to give you money. Because if you do not have a permit by UCC, it means that I will give you money today, and tomorrow, UCC will come and close you down. And if UCC closes you down, your money is gone.
So the guy giving you the money is looking to mitigate his own risk.
Exactly. He's managing his own risk primarily. Mm. So he's saying, I'm getting money. Yes, you'll give me a little bit of cost of money. You'll give me a bit of interest and a return on my money. But I need to make sure that I will actually get my money back.
Back.
Mm. Not only, I have to get, because remember, most of the time, it's not his money. It is somebody else's money.
If it's a banker, it's a depositor's money.
Depositor's money. So you've got to remember that this person is not giving you their own money. So they want to make sure that they'll get the principal plus this other cost of money back, the return that they expect. How do you get that? So for a business, and now we're talking about businesses that have, we passed the other stage. We're not a lifestyle. An opportunity has come up. We want to run long term, and we see an opportunity to grow. The first thing that businesses have to have is, you know, you have to have financial records. You have to have your financial records. You have to build a track. You have to build a track of financial records. For businesses, you need to make sure that at least as a minimum, at a half year, you have your half year records. Say, okay, we sold so much. This was the cost of running the business. So you have to have at least an accountant on tap who does your accounts and is able to say, even if you don't have him as a full-time employee, at least somebody who goes through your records and say, these are your management accounts. Then at the end of the year, somebody external audits your accounts. Now, audits are expensive. An auditor might ask you for 5, maybe 6 million if you're a small business, maybe 4, because that tends to be about the minimum that auditor will ask you for. But when you have audited accounts, these are considered records of the business. And this is the part that's very difficult for young, nouveau, new businessmen to understand, that audited accounts is as an opinion. They go through the records and they form an opinion about your books.
Whether these are well-kept books or not.
Well-kept books or not. So if they're not well-kept books, your auditor states his opinion, and business people have to really look for this, because sometimes the auditors actually do state that there are certain areas where we have doubt. And this can be missed. It's very easy to miss it and not understand it. But you need to make sure that we have given a green light on these books. They are clean books. This is the proper statement of these accounts. We've accepted them, and you hand them over. And I think there's also been a raft of auditors, but you need to be very careful. Banks also have auditors who they believe and those they don't believe. Mm-hmm. So it's also very important, if you're thinking that I want to go to bank X, to do a little bit of, take a little bit of legwork, go to the bank, meet a customer relationship person, say, what are your requirements? Who are your approved auditors? Who are your approved valuers? Who are your, because if the person that you bring forth They might read the books and they might say, okay, that's fine. But if they're not on their list, it might not be accepted. So it is these series of things that need to be put together, and sometimes they are quite a bit of work.
So financial readiness would be to all people who would support your business. So you could have banks and
you could have suppliers. It's to everybody.
Yeah, even suppliers.
Even suppliers. You could have a supplier who wants to give you supplier credit. It's also very common. And sometimes you have suppliers and they're willing to give you 30 days or they're willing to give you 45 days of credit. This is very common. And they might want to know, they might have a few questions that they can ask.
About your business. They don't give you stuff and then you
vanish off and something happens to you. So supplier credit is a very good way to finance a business, especially one that requires a lot of
supplier money. Credit would be like Yuga Chick wants to support my chicken's outlet and they'll give me chicken for...
Yes, you have a restaurant.
I don't have to pay for 40 days. Okay,
yes.
Yeah, a restaurant.
You have a restaurant and you have a small takeaway and we have a good understanding and you say, okay, we will supply you and on the 30th day of the month, you will pay the invoices that were raised until the 15th. That gives you 15 days of supply before which you have to pay the amount. So that's 15 days where you don't have to pay one supplier, and that is a very strong way to finance
a business.
Yes, but are you ready for it?
Yes.
Hypothetically, for
YugaCheck to do this, they would have to. Okay, apart from your past record with them, they might probably want to say, let's see your financial records of
the
last...
They say, want to know, who are you? Where is your business? Where is located? How long have you been in business? What are you... What do you have? And sometimes, YugaCheck might not, as a company, we might not, because we supply, you know, very... We supply item food stuff. So we might not be... What we might actually come to you is we might say, look, we just want the bank to guarantee that if we give you 50 million shillings, you will pay it. We just want a bank guarantee. Mm. It's sufficient for us. Mm. We're not really interested in your books of accounts. Just give us a bank guarantee.
Yeah. So the bank
is the bank is the one that has to do the due diligence before it issues the guarantee.
Because they have 50 million on the line.
They have 50 million that they would have to pitch if you turned out and you didn't pay. So the bank will ask you for a series of questions and then they will give you that guarantee based on that. So that's, you know, all those are ways and means to be able to give firmness to the person who you're supposed to pay. But how does somebody know?
So there's value in all that paperwork.
I've
been a business journalist for a while and people are like, all that paper, filling. But there is value, as you explained, that, you know, you could, and as you say, it can also be a financing mean to justify financing like supplier credit.
Correct. And also lastly, Paul, the other point is that as you improve your readiness and you are able to provide this information, and this information is almost voluntary, you know, very similar to how you see public companies have to just publish this stuff, it has to be done, your risk factor drops. Which if your risk factor drops, you could find that if the prime rate is 18, you're paying prime plus 1 or prime plus 2, while everyone else is paying prime plus 4. Or prime plus 5, yes. I mean, so it's also in time decreases the cost of money to you as a business.
Because essentially, the people lending you the money think this guy is not as risky
as the other.
He will not decide exactly. It's a comparison game.
It's a comparison. Yes, correct.
So and there's something interesting. All this, if you wrap it all up in a sense that it's big word called strategy. I'm sure it works, and especially I imagine for you people who've been in business so long. Strategy. What is strategy? What does it look like, and why is it important at all?
Yeah, I think. I mean, strategy can be very complicated. Also, can be understood differently by different people. Strategy is what a business. Where is the business going to play? What is a business going to really do? Who is a business going to serve? And who is a business not going to serve? I think that these are equally as important. Who are you not going to serve? Where are you not going to do business? That's a large component of what the strategy of a business could be. A business could appear from the outset that, look, you know, my focus is I am a small petrol station on Gaza Road, but you're a small station amidst so many of these big, what are you going to do? I mean, you see it if you drive to Bombo Road, there's so many stations, but they sell their petrol very, very cheap. It's the cheapest, it's one of the cheapest neighborhoods for comparatively for fuel. And they have decided that they have a method to whatever it may be, that their fuel is cheaper, maybe because they have a lot of long distance drivers and who want to buy it in bulk, and maybe they consume larger amounts. So you decide, I supply buses. I supply the buses that are going to Gulu or going very far. And I know that when they stop to consume, they consume 300 liters as opposed to the border that takes 3 or 5 liters. So I don't need to have as much a margin because I'm selling on volume. That's the strategy of that station.
And that location.
And the people you serve. And then at that point in time, I don't think that you refuse to serve a border when they stop. But I am sure the way the station is structured, the station is very well geared to serving a bus or the big volume buyer. There's certain things that they will give the big volume buyers. And that works well for that particular business. You have to decide, are you going to play in the field and long term and adapt to different things that are going to come up with the market? Are you going to be able to look at all the customers in the marketplace? Can you serve every single person in the marketplace and not serve some serve the others? Sometimes you might want to know that, okay, I serve specific businesses because I like, I can deal with this particular type of business that works for me, and you do it. And that's how you focus your customer service and your customer experience. It's on a specific type of customer. So
it's not something to be done by big corporates only. Even you and your small little store,
yes,
you have to make a decision. That's where strategy actually begins.
Exactly. And you make your decision. It doesn't have to be in writing and doesn't have to be on a poster either. You make a decision. In here, I do deliveries to certain type of clients. I serve them, I sell them juice, so I make them this product. And I have my list of clients, and the clients, they understand me. They know either I'm in the health business, I don't do certain things, or, whatever choices you make. So you make a series of choices, and then you need to figure out, are those choices sufficient to serve you? And at that point in time, that's where you have to be out there actively investigating and looking and interrogating your strategy. Does it really work?
In the market. Because you can have a beautiful strategy and the market just says nope.
Nope, yeah. The market doesn't. So, I mean, we've seen big businesses come and do well. But at the end of the day, everybody says, but, you know, I think that their strategy was not right. They were not really aiming. Maybe they were better in French-speaking Africa. Or maybe they are very good in South Africa, but they're not very good here. Or maybe, you know, there is always something that, you know, sooner or later people start to say that, you know, they just never got there. They never were able to deal with this market. There was not sufficient numbers of X or Y or Z. And we've seen very, very big businesses who are actually quite intelligent, and they have lots of analysts, and they're smart businesses, and they come and it doesn't work very well here.
So strategy is not set in stone.
No.
It's a thought. You think, let's assume you did at the beginning of the business. Now you get the rubber hits the road and you realize, people probably don't eat gizzards in this place. So I better
I need to steer a little bit to the left. Or maybe I need to focus a little bit more on these products. Maybe I do the gizzards as just a giveaway. Maybe I just need to get the people to learn how to consume these things, you know. So that's I mean, people will have to make these choices, and your customers at the end of the day are the most important thing.
Absolutely. No customers, no business.
It's a business. No customer, no business. Yes.
I've seen a big company now has modified its offerings to the market. It's now selling rice and chicken strips, which is good for you guys. They have to adapt to the market. Ask guys.
Correct. And do not be surprised if you wake up one day and they're selling, in certain markets, they will sell maybe rice and a little bit of ugali.
Absolutely.
It's possible. And in certain global market, globally, there are some places where they do sell ugali. So, because people like that sort of thing. So
no, you make ugali, we don't turn up.
No, ugali, we don't show up. Yes.
But, so there's strategy. And then there's culture. And people tell that company's culture is not up to scratch. And I've had it said that culture, and you guys and management, that culture starts from the top. It's not the bottom. There's no culture which starts from the bottom, from the grassroots guy. How important is that? Have you found that in your businesses, the culture in the business?
Culture is very important.
First of all, what is culture?
Culture are the things you will allow people to do, are the things you will not allow, that the teams are not acceptable. What is not acceptable, what is acceptable in that team? Now, culture can be, what do people wear to work? Mm-hmm. Culture can be, what time do people show up to work? Culture can be that there are organizations, there are many organizations, Paul, you've seen them. People actually show up on time very early in the morning, but they spend 4 or 5 hours not doing very much work. And then you have organizations where performance is very important, but maybe the time is not as important, because the culture is about what do you deliver. So it's a different, and there is no one size fits all in this particular culture story. You can't say that that's the right culture. The culture of company X or law firm Y or law firm Z will make success for law firm AB, new one that's starting up. No, it's a lot about DNA. It's a lot about the founders themselves.
If the founders like to sleep in late, then maybe your company will all be late.
A little bit late. People might actually come in late, but they might actually work till late hours. They might have figured out something that, you know, maybe there is not very much activity within their client base very early in the morning. It might be one of those things. The biggest, and I think the culture that I like to speak about, and I like to spend a bit of time in, is the culture. That the culture that is talked about a little bit less, Paul, is the culture of corruption within the private sector, within our own organizations. Mm-hmm. The culture where people want to take a little bit of what's on the table, and there's a feeling that there is a purchase, and I'm going to buy so many reams of paper. The person needs to provide a room. I think that's the one that I think that we in I call it corporate or private sector Uganda tend to want to not speak about a lot. But that culture sometimes comes from fairly higher up. Sometimes it comes from just everybody believing that from your work is where you need to get. You need to get something.
Beyond your salary.
You need to be over and above. And I think there is a challenge. I think we've got a bit of a challenge where all us in general have to sort of come and sit down and think a little bit more. We have to increase our discipline levels. We try very hard to make sure that, you know, we're very hard on
maybe it's because the workers don't recognize the connection between the health of the business and their own well-being.
Possible.
You suggest we as business owners, business managers, people should bring everybody on board, post up your P&Ls every every half year or every month if need be, so that you see.
Paul, P&L is not very easy for people to quite understand. So the P&L can mean so many different things to different
people. Profit and loss statement.
Yes, your profit and loss. It might not be very easy for everybody to grasp it.
Mm.
My thinking is that the leaders, it has to start with the leaders. The leaders have to show a good example. The leaders have to lead by example. The leaders have to be very firm when cases are proven or when cases are thought to be, when these cases of pilferage are known, they should be very hard on them. I believe that it starts with us, the leaders, and I don't see any other way. I think every alternative I think is going to be a half effort. I think it just has to start, and you will see that the organizations that are well led and there's a strong amount of integrity along the way, it tends to be less and less and less and less. And you know, but it's not very easy to completely root out, but it is easy to minimize it to a point where when it does happen, it is recognized, it is understood as what it is, for what it is, and nobody thinks, well, you know, I mean, because I think one of the things is it's an ambiguity, and people think, well, maybe he was just earning a small commission, maybe he was, that's where the source of the problem might be. It needs to be very clear and understood from the beginning. So I think, to me, that's the one culture thing I tend to like to talk about. The rest about dress code and, you know, how people behave, I think that's a lot, you know, people have to be trained, how they meet their customers, how they speak to their customers. That everybody needs to see. And again, it's a leadership. A lot stems from leadership.
And finally, I think to wrap up this program, it's been very insightful. You're a family business. You have family businesses. And you're a family business. Transition is a big deal. Scary statistic from many years ago, Enterprise Uganda kept saying that there's no indigenous company that has transitioned from one generation to the next. You're grappling with that just by sheer force of nature. What are your thoughts on it, and how are you guys trying to navigate this?
I think you've got to remember that the business community here has been disrupted. Of course, you know, you had years when there wasn't, you know, much business going on. So there was almost a reset. You know, there was almost a reset at some point, you know, 30 couple of years ago. So yes, we are about at that point in time where, you know, there is quite a few transitions. There is a transition has to be prepared for. It has to be accepted that it is going to happen. I think that that's normally the starting point. A transition is going to happen. What is going to happen in the next? What is planned for? The approach that we take is that you're not going to be able to plan out every single detail on the flip side of this particular transition, but the big general things have to be in place. You know, risk appetite, the team members, what is the business going to look like after the transition? Those things have to be thought about and thought
succession,
have to be thought through. I think we're beginning to see well managed successions. Time will tell. Are they going to run their time and get to the next succession? Because I think that's the only time you will know
that
the succession worked. Unfortunately, you can't know by just the fact that the succession has happened and everything has remained. Because you also have to remember that a business is also a function of its own, of the context, of the market, of the competition. There are many other things that are going on around the business. The business is not just the business on its own. There are many other things that are happening around it. There are mergers, there are acquisitions. There's so many things that could happen. But we're now beginning to see where founders are preparing this whole next generation story. How is it going to work? You know, choosing teams. That's really now a process that.
Isn't it almost like starting a business again? You're going back to where we started this conversation.
No, because there is already a business.
There's already a business.
One of the things that, remember that there's already a business. There is wealth now. Wealth has been built over time. There is a brand name. There is a bit of a product. You're no longer dealing with there is nothing. You're no longer dealing with we need to look for anchors. No, this has already been done. Anchor is there. You have quite a bit of boat already built.
Yeah.
Now the question is, are you going to continue into these rough seas? Are you going to go out to the bigger lake, bigger oceans? Are you going to stay in your small pond? What are you going to do with your boat as you change the captain of the boat? We like to think about it as a process, and it has to be an ongoing process. It's a process that has to be worked on every single day, as opposed to making it an event.
Yeah.
You know, if it is just an event that happens, it takes over. It will be in charge of itself. So it's got to be something that is prepared for, and understood that is going to happen. I tease quite a bit of my other colleagues that certain cultures don't want to talk about death.
Yes.
And I think that this tends to be a big barrier. I think that if a culture has a big inhibition around talking about death, because when you talk about it, it will happen.
Don't want to jinx it.
You don't want to call it. So that I think is a problem, and I think that is a bad start. I think that it needs to be accepted. And I think Islam is very good about that. For Islam does not have doubt. There is no doubt. It is a fundamental part of believing and being a believer. And I'm not to say that one or the other. And I think other religions are the same. They do accept that there is a life after. But I know that, you know, Islam, it's unequivocal. You have to accept it. It is part of acceptance, part of being a believer. And we are able to talk about it without having any cultural inhibitions. I encourage business owners to take or remove that inhibition off the table and say, what happens when I pass?
The
bus hits you. What happens if I'm not here? What would you like? How would you like this to be? That has to be a constant discussion. It has to be a constant discussion. And surprisingly, for families in business, it starts to become almost even a dinner table discussion. As much as it sounds quite gory and quite morbid, it becomes a dinner table without being, not in its morbidity, but not in its gory nature, but in that whole process, it becomes very clear that this person is going to be doing this, this person does this right now, they'll be the person.
And also there's an opportunity for the person who will be succeeded to actually share his vision.
Exactly. His post-self vision.
Or even his, you know, sometimes we hang on to these things in our head and we don't tell people what we're thinking.
Yes.
But if you know that, if you've accepted that this will pass, so I've got to let people know, that's what he's thinking. That's why he's done this. That's why he set it up here.
Exactly.
Whether we can do it better or not is another thing, but we know now why he did
this. A, B, C, D. So, the inhibitions, and I think are important. And I think here, I would speak a lot to my employees in my business, and you know, I would talk to them about if I wasn't there, and I would notice that some of them would really be taken aback and shocked. Why would you say that? So my take and the thing that I say is it needs to be very current and upfront and on the table. It needs to be, it's a bit harder when you're much younger, when you're in your 40s or in your 50s, but you know, suddenly once you start age a little bit, I think it needs to be a very current discussion.
Yeah. One final thought. What do you think about maybe the offspring or the children of the founder don't have to be necessarily the successors to the business?
Correct. I understand. I think the question that you raise is that there is there is many factors that work, especially sometimes you might find that none of them is interested. You might find that none of them is capable. You know, you might find that maybe there's a few of them who are capable. There might be, there might be many and a few of them are capable. There might be a need for a bit more integration of professionals. A business has to determine at which stage is what's the life cycle? Where on the life cycle of business is the business itself? Where is it? Is it at that point in time where it needs to professionalize? So that might be whereby it might need to call on somebody without the name, without the owner name, to come up front and to sort of start to steer the business. I determined early on in the media business that, you know, the media business is a night and day, 24/7 business. We call them dog years. I mean, they 1 year in the media business is 5 years in every
normal life.
Because you're working all day, all night, 5 o'clock in the morning, every time. We determined that at 10 years, the business was equivalent of a 35-year-old business.
Mm.
So it had to go completely, you know, it had to transit completely and become fully professional. And you have to do it while you're there, so that you can still oversee, still guide, still be able to. But once you have the comfort of letting go, you learn that actually, you know,
it can work without you.
It can work, and sometimes it can be even more successful without the founder. So the transition is not as scary. It's not as scary, but some businesses are very intense and they require quite a lot of, and everybody will tell you one thing or the other, depending on, my business is special. Mm-hmm. Everybody's business is special. It's very special. I'm the one who knows everything about it. I know the nuts and bolts. I know where the skeletons
are. The corners.
I know all the corners, yes. But there is a point in time when it is important that maybe large chunks of the business start to be run. So you have to only hold on to the really, really, really special things. And ultimately, you'll find they are fewer and fewer and fewer every day. So I think that allows us to become much more disposed to discussing succession and life without us running these businesses.
Your final thoughts?
We have a long way to go. We have, as a country and in this whole, we've been fortunate. I don't know, maybe it's something to be, we're landlocked and we're small, so we've not had as big an invasion of foreign businesses. So we still have a lot of opportunities as indigenous players. I think that there is a lot to do to bring all our teams and colleagues and potential businesses to become educated to modern ways, because out there it's brutal. If you operate in other areas or you've done business in other places, the markets can be quite harsh, and competition is strong and ruthless. So there's plenty of opportunity. There's plenty of opportunity for indigenous businesses in Uganda. And my thought is that it's important that the people that have been able to do a few things are able to pass on their knowledge, and they're able to discuss and learn from one another, and to be able to share what works and what doesn't work. And that's perhaps one of the reasons why we've had this conversation today.
On that, stepping up our game note, we have to bring this program of Checkpoint to a close. I've been Paul Busharizi, your host. It's been a pleasure talking to Aga Sekalala Jr. Of Sekalala and Companies. We better know them for their Yuga Chick project. Thank you very much for being with us.